If you're running sound at a live show in 2024, whether you're mixing in a small club, house of worship, or a music festival, you're probably using a digital mixing console. And there are some very good reasons for that. Let's look at the features that set digital mixers apart from analog mixers, making them the primary choice for live shows of all sizes. I'll be using the Tascam SonicView 24 for the demonstrations in this video, but most of these principles apply to digital consoles in general. If you want to learn more about the SonicView 24, check out the links in the description below. Thanks to Tascam for sponsoring this video and supporting audio education. As you might already know, analog mixers usually have a channel strip for each input. If you're running sound for a band, for example, you might have a channel strip for kick drum, snare drum, overhead, bass, guitar, vocal, and so on. One drawback of this layout is that each additional input on stage will require a physical channel strip on the mixer. And eventually, you could end up with a giant console if the show requires a bunch of channels. This not only takes up space, but also requires a lot of lifting. Now I've got your attention. With a digital console, on the other hand, you can fit many more channels into a much smaller footprint. That's because the same knobs and faders can be used for multiple purposes. This console allows for up to 44 input channels, even though there are only 24 input faders. Rather than using channel strips, you just select the channel you want to control, and the channel processing appears on these screens. So I can select the snare channel and adjust the snare EQ and the snare dynamics on these screens, and then select the kick channel and adjust those settings using the same screens and the same knobs. Alternatively, I can put the snare EQ on one screen and the kick EQ on another screen and adjust them at the same time. Not only does this method save space horizontally on the console, but it also provides the opportunity to include a lot of additional processing per channel. More on that in a moment. First, I want to mention that the faders can also be shared on a digital console utilizing layers. Rather than being restricted to the number of physical faders on the mixing surface, digital consoles often have motorized faders, providing customizable banks that can be accessed with a simple press of a button. Over here on the right side, I can select one of these layers to toggle between each bank of channels. Right out of the box, these are set pretty logically, but once you get a hang of using a particular console, you can start creating your own custom layouts. You may have noticed that there's no need for console tape here. In this case, I can color code my channel groups, I can label each channel, and even add an icon for each input with the built-in LCD displays. Maybe you want the drums on one layer, the vocals on the next layer, and the effects returns on another layer. Or maybe you want all of the essential channels for a particular show on a single layer. You can even set up DCAs, where you can consolidate several channels into one fader for easier control of, say, the drum kit, keeping all of the individual drum channels on a different layer. The motorized faders also provide easy access to monitor and effect sends. While you could use these aux send knobs to create a monitor mix for each musician on stage, similar to an analog console, a digital console like the SonicView allows you to turn the faders into aux sends. And once you get used to this sends on fader workflow is a lot faster than using knobs. You can even set up these user keys so that each one of these is a different mix. So here's monitor 1, monitor 2, monitor 3. Maybe the person with monitor 3 needs a little bit more lead vocal, and the person with monitor 2 needs a little bit less. And then I can deselect that and I'm back to my front of house mix. You can even put the graphic EQ for your monitor outputs on the faders and quickly attenuate frequencies as feedback occurs. That reminds me, in addition to more inputs, you can also facilitate a lot more outputs with the digital console. This board has 22 outputs in addition to the main left and right bus. You just couldn't expect that from an analog console of a similar size. Over the last few decades, the amount of equipment needed to run a live show has dramatically decreased. And that's a good thing for touring engineers and stagehands everywhere. In addition to the heavy, relatively low power amplifiers and the large format analog consoles, audio crews of the past also had to lug around big racks of outboard gear. In a typical live sound front of house rack, you might find outboard EQs, compressors, gates, digital reverb units, delay units, and each of these can only be used once. If you needed to put a gate on every drum in a five-piece drum kit, You didn't just load up the same plugin on every channel. You carried around a physical analog gate processor for every instance you intended to use. Plus, as I already mentioned, the channel strip processors built into the mixer required actual electronics, leading to additional weight, space requirements, and heat. Digital consoles don't need all of those electronics. The EQs and dynamics processors are digital, and therefore, you can have one on every channel without taking up any additional space on the truck. The time-based effects are also digital and controllable from right here on the mixing surface. This console has 4 stereo effects returns and built-in effects processors. And for each effects slot, you can choose whichever reverb, delay, or modulation effect you want. For the same functionality in an analog setup, you'd need at least 4 RU of outboard rack space, plus the analog ins and outs. I'm personally a bit too young to remember the days of carrying around all of this stuff, so it's easy for me to forget how lucky modern engineers have it. But when you stop and think about it, it's incredible how far technology has come. Now, I've got nothing against analog, trust me, but the value for your money, the practicality, and the power of a digital console is undeniable, and we're just getting started. Have you ever been stuck putting the front of house console on the side of the stage? This is a common scenario in smaller shows and corporate shows where aesthetics are often prioritized over audio quality. The issue is, of course, that you have to mix from a location behind the speakers, which makes no sense. But some digital consoles are capable of wireless control with a tablet. In these cases, you just download the app, connect the console and tablet to a common Wi-Fi router, and now you can walk around the audience and mix from a sensible location where you can actually hear what you're doing. This also comes in handy when you want to adjust preamp gain and graphic EQ settings on stage to ring out floor wedges, create a rough monitor mix before performers show up, or tweak the mix to sound good in various locations throughout the audience. It can sometimes be intimidating walking into a show where you'll be using an unfamiliar mixer. You can try to prepare as much as possible by looking at pictures online, but in the back of your mind, you may still dread the situation where the show starts in 15 minutes and you still can't even get signal to pass. I've been there. Luckily, more and more digital console manufacturers provide offline editors that you can install on a computer to experiment with the console's interface, even if you don't have the physical console right there in the room with you. That way, you can at least become familiar with the user interface ahead of time rather than showing up blind. But you can also take it a step further and create a template for your show that can be loaded into the console when you arrive on site. Even if you don't go through the process of pre-planning a console file like this, the value of recalling settings on a digital console can't be overstated. Think about it. All of those knobs on an analog mixer are not motorized. That means you're pretty much stuck with a pencil and notebook if you want to preserve the settings for a particular show or artist. Every EQ, every compressor, every control has to be manually adjusted in order to recreate a mix. And don't forget the patching of all of that outboard gear and the settings on the outboard gear too. With digital, as you might expect, this isn't a problem. Not only can you create presets for EQ and compression, but you can also recall layouts, scenes, and snapshots of the entire mix. This is very useful for dialing in a mix for each band during soundcheck that can be recalled later on throughout the show. Or if you're touring with a band consistently, you can even go so far as to create a snapshot for every song. If you've only been in this industry for a relatively short period of time, you may be unimpressed by all of these features because you've always used a digital console. I find myself taking this stuff for granted all the time. I get it. But remember, analog consoles and analog outboard gear used to be the only option. So consider yourself lucky the next time you're stacking cases. It could be worse. You can also feel fortunate if you've been tasked to run the snake in a situation where the snake is just a mere Ethernet cable or two. With analog consoles and some digital consoles, every individual microphone has to be routed to a snake head on stage, which is connected to a snake head at front of house via a long bundle of analog cables called a snake. Let's say it's a 48-channel snake. This means the analog snake that connects the stage to front of house has 48 individual analog cables in it, and that's just the input side. You'll also have a drive snake to send signals back from front of house to the amps on stage. Analog snakes are heavy, bulky, difficult to roll out, and difficult to clean up especially after a 16-hour day. It's by no means fun to run any kind of snake, but if you're going to run one, you'd prefer it to be digital. Digital snakes are commonly coaxial cables or Ethernet cables, which can carry dozens of channels of audio over a single cable. So they tend to be much lighter and easier to maneuver. If you're using a Dante connection, which is how you connect the Sonic View to this SB16D stage box, you can simply connect the console and the stage box to a network switch with Ethernet cables. Then the console can route 16 channels in and 16 channels out of the stage box and control the preamps on the stage box. Dante supports more than 16 channels though. In this case, up to 64 channels. Therefore, you could potentially add additional stage boxes across the stage. Each stage box connects to the switch at the side of the stage via Ethernet cables, and then a single Ethernet cable connects the switch to the front of house console. Much easier than analog cabling. Alternatively, you can daisy chain several SB16D stage boxes together for use without a network switch. In addition to the ease of deployment and cleanup, digital snakes also offer additional benefits. If you were to loom two Ethernet cables together, you could create redundancy by utilizing the primary and secondary ports on each Dante device. So the system can automatically switch over if one cable fails. You could even go a step further and use a redundant network switch. Now, if any of the cables or the network switch itself should fail, the Dante network will switch over to the redundant ports automatically, and that happens so quickly, the switch is completely inaudible. Some digital consoles, including the Sonic View, will have a port for recording to an SD card and a USB port that allows for multi-track recording to a laptop. This feature can be used to capture each microphone to a separate track for mixing later on. The multi-track feature can also be used for virtual sound check. Let's say you tour with a band and use the same mics every show. During the first show, you could capture the multi-track recording straight off of the board, either using the USB connection or a Dante interface. Then you could arrive at the next venue the next day before the band even gets there and sets up their instruments. You could play the multi-track session from the laptop and route the channels back into the mixer and dial in the mix using the input signals from the first show. The band shows up, you place the mics in the same place as you always do, and the show is mostly mixed. This is also a useful technique for newer engineers to practice mixing live tracks. Of course, there won't be any chance of feedback in this scenario as there will be during a real show, but it's a really great way to practice mixing when you're not in front of a live audience. Let me know in the comments if you'd like to learn more about setting up a virtual sound check in a future video. Check out the Tascam Sonic View using the links below this video and watch the video that's on your screen to learn about mixing with an analog console. Even though there are a lot of advantages to using digital, it's still very helpful to learn on an analog console because many of the same mixing and routing principles apply. I'll see you there.